me. Nothing quite like all this color. Couldn't paint a better day. Got good times on the horizon. I can see them on the way. Couple birds came up beside me. Had to feed them some Bob Marley. Swear I heard them angel calls. Lay outside as heaven falls. Heaven falls. Heaven falls. As heaven falls.
Good morning, KW Milwaukee. I hope everybody's having a beautiful start to your Tuesday morning for what will be a gorgeous and phenomenal 4th of July week/weekend. So we'll jump right into it. So just a few logistical updates to update the group this week. Because the 4th of July does fall on a Saturday, we have a little bit of a change in schedule. As it just relates to some office logistics. So historically, we had always closed the offices at noon on the 3rd to give the team a chance to go out and enjoy the day with their families and friends. So we will be doing that this year on Thursday, July 2nd. The office will be closing at noon, both locations, North Shore and Lake Country. Agents, again, always have access to the offices for closings, for meeting with clients or anything 24/7. It's just the leadership teams will be off on Thursday at noon. And then Friday, in observance of 4th of July holiday, Friday, July 3rd, offices will be closed. And then next week, Tuesday, July 7th, there will be no team meeting. So just want to make sure that that is on everyone's radar. So, as a follow-up to last week's conversation around defending your commission, last night I was perusing through Facebook and I saw two posts that caught my eye that totally made me jump and I loved it. So the first one I wanted to share with you, Peter G, I know a ton of people have already seen it, but wanted to share this with the group. First, this home was for sale by owner, then for sale by Shore West, then by Remax, then by Excel, which is a discount broker. And then moved under, and it didn't go under contract by Keller Williams. It went under contract by Peter G. So Peter G, congrats. You had a strategy and you implemented to get this house sold. So congrats on that. And then the second one, who I'm actually going to ask to jump on the call this morning, is Ross Treffer. So Ross last night posted this. He said, another crazy weekend with a new listing. After 17 showings, 7 offers, within 2 days on the market, we are officially under contract. The home was previously listed by a discount broker who, rather than put in the time and effort to properly list the home, simply suggested multiple reductions in price. We put together a professional listing strategy that ended up getting the sellers multiple offer for tens of thousands over asking price. And get this, they even listed it for $8,000 more than before. Ross, jump on. Tell us about your strategy and what you went after to go get this thing done.
Yeah, thanks, Charlie. So this one specifically, it was an interesting situation. The seller had reached out and obviously they had expired the contract with their previous broker. It was a power of attorney that was selling the home for a family member, and the family member had some life things happening and essentially had the home rented out for the last year and a half, 2 years. And it got beat up a little bit. There were certainly some projects to do around the house. And she essentially said that the other broker had promised her that they were going to come in and fix some of these things and do some of those projects to take care of it since it was vacant. None of that ever happened. So they listed the home. The photos were taken with an iPhone. He didn't even open up a single blind. He didn't take the dishes out of the sink in the kitchen, didn't run a vacuum in the bedrooms, and it was a mess. So we came through with our professional strategy that we talk a lot about at the J. Schmidt Group, professional marketing, photography, staging. In this case, it took me going over there and cutting the grass, cleaning windows, coordinating contractors, scrubbing a bathroom floor. Like, it was all the stuff that you don't always want to do as a real estate agent, but if someone were to tell you, I'm willing to pay you X amount of money to go do this stuff, I mean, would you do it? Absolutely. So we put that together and ended up first day on the market getting multiple offers, one of which, a great offer, came in from Brian Pat. Unfortunately, we weren't able to make it come together, so I apologize there.
I hate you.
Sellers were very, very happy at the end of the day.
That's awesome. Ross, congrats. I love, hearing the success stories, especially when it, you know, if you look at, I always look at time as it relates to return on the investment of your time, right? And what your hourly rate is. And to your point, right? Like, to mow the grass, to clean some windows, and maybe even scrub a bathroom, like the return on that time for day one accepted offer is awesome to hear those results. So congrats.
Thank you. And then Charlie, I don't know how much time I have, but if I wanted to kind of follow up on last week's conversation with Marcus and Maureen.
Yeah, shoot.
So one of the things that I always do is I always include in my listing presentation a net seller sheet. And if you go to our Facebook page and just if you search for a file and simply type in seller net sheet, Kimmy Herbert uploaded this, I think 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, but type in the seller net sheet, and Charlie, maybe we can include that in our notes. But it gives a breakdown of what the sellers are ultimately going to walk away with at the end of the day. And I think when it comes to defending your commission, Marcus said it really well last week when he said, you really need to believe that you are worth 6%. And usually when it comes to that conversation with a seller, it's not the dollar amount that they're typically concerned with. It's more of just that 6% that they get hung up on. So my plan A and then my plan B when I go into those listing appointments. So this one I was able to take from a discount broker. We took it at 6% plus our $695 because we were able to offer so much more value than that other brokerage, that other agent. But one of the things I always like to break down for sellers is, what is 1%? That we're talking about here. So in this case, the list price on this house was $150,000. So if I drop to 5%, that's $1,500 that we're negotiating with. The last agent that you had, who obviously didn't market your property properly, they didn't do everything that they were supposed to do, their first reaction to you not getting an offer price at 142 was to drop it to 135. So that $1,500 that you saved on your commission, or maybe even let's call it $3,000, maybe you took it at 4%, cost the seller $7,000. to have that type of an agent working for them. So really just focus on the numbers and what you're really talking about back and forth. The other thing too, this is more of a conversation for you to understand what that value really is. But if you think about an agent that rather than properly market a home and do the work for 6%, if they take it at 5% and they ask you for a price reduction down the road, a $5,000 price reduction, if they're earning 2.6% because they dropped to 5%, so they're earning 2.6% on that listing, dropping price by $5,000 only costs them $130 in commission. It costs the seller $5,000, but it costs them $130. So what are they going to do? Are they going to spend more time and money trying to market your property? Or are they going to try to get you to drop price so that the property moves and it doesn't really cost them anything? Really doesn't cost them anything. The other thing that we do is if sellers are really pushing back on that 6% commission, I learned this partly from Jay. Actually, everything that I've talked to and done on listing appointments, I've stolen from somebody else, other agents in Keller Williams. So please leverage all of the knowledge that people are willing to share. None of this is my own, but it's all taken from other agents. But my plan B, if they really can't come to that 6%, is sharing in the pain with them. So essentially talking about, if we can't get X price, I will reduce my commission to 5.5% or 5% because I didn't promise you what we talked about. So I shouldn't earn the full commission that we've discussed. So it's another way for you to write that maybe into the contract or into an amendment that says, hey, if I need to ask you for a $10,000 price reduction, I also should feel that pain. So I'm willing to drop 1%. But I, like I said, those are the things that I've learned. That seller net sheet is a huge, it's a huge game changer when it comes to really talking about the numbers at the end of the day, what the sellers are going to walk away with. Because typically that's really what they get hung up on, is that 6%, not necessarily just the number. So yeah, I'll leave it at that. Thank you, Charlie, for letting me kind of piggyback on the conversations that Marcus and Maureen had last week.
No, I thought it was perfect timing and so apropos. You know, one is this week when we send out our resources guide in the follow-up email this afternoon, I'll make sure to include the seller net sheet within that email. We'll also have Kimmy repost it to all the Facebook pages. But the key message here is Ross very clearly understands a relationship between cost and return on investment, right? And he can clearly communicate to the client, you can do this at X cost, but what is the return that you're actually sacrificing as it relates to your list price, right? And he's able to defend that commission because he understands the relationship between cost or expense as it relates to the return on the investment on their balance sheet. So Ross, thanks for sharing. That was like perfectly timed follow-up to last week's conversation. Awesome. Thanks, Ross. Cool. We'll jump into, I want to shift gears here too, to talk about something, and this is going to be brief, but I want to touch on this because I want to remind our group as it relates to COVID, and I want to just pull a few things, right? If you look here, here's the latest coronavirus stats in the state of Wisconsin, and is what we've seen here, the trend nationally is what we're seeing here locally as well, where there's been an uptick in cases here heading into the 4th of July weekend. A couple things that I kind of dug into as it relates to this, and this is really, I don't mean to fearmonger, I don't mean to kind of reiterate anything that the media is kind of spinning out of control. I just want to provide you some basic facts to just be knowledgeable as it relates to how we can do our jobs professionally at the highest level. So here are some insights for you. The positivity rate through Sunday, 6/28, was 7.1%. It was the second highest percentage of positive tests since May. For perspective, early June, we were hovering around 3% to 2.5%. The CDC guidelines for a pandemic, really, once you get as a consistent rate below 2%, we're in really good shape. So you can see that trend is actually going in the wrong direction. And the biggest factor in that trend going in the wrong direction is 41% of positive tests in the state of Wisconsin have come from people who are in their 20s versus 22% of early tests, right? So we're seeing a very strong surge of test groupings from individuals in their 20s. A lot of this has to relate to social activities and things like that. And then what I did is I dug into it a little bit more specifically. If you look at it, Waukesha County now has just over 1,100 cases. Milwaukee County has 11,000 cases. For perspective, as it relates to total population, total population of those who are infected, Waukesha and Milwaukee are actually seeing the same number of incidences per 1,000 people. So I use this as a platform to making sure that we're staying aware of what's going on in our world, and we're continuing to take the necessary precautions as it relates to this disease, and that we are instilling confidence in our list, in our buyers and our sellers, that we're taking the necessary precautions. One thing I did want to point out, I know last week, Tuesday afternoon, we sent out an email specifically to the North Shore. We did not send it to Lake Country, that we did have an agent test positive for COVID in the North Shore. There was minimal interaction with other people within our offices, and those interactions that the agent did have, we had those people tested. It all came back negative, which is really, really great. It means nobody else was infected by it. But I did ask, because he shared his story on Facebook. They got a utilize you and the platform to just kind of educate our group on what that process looked like for both you and Alicia, having just recently gone through this.
Yeah, so it was me. I still have it. I likely will still have it in my system as dead RNA for the next week or so. But thank you to everyone who's reached out and, you know, checked on me. And I really appreciate the phone calls and the text messages. But it's definitely a very real thing, and it's a very scary thing. And it's not necessarily scary in how it affects your body, but it's scary in the confusion, because no one really knows. No one has this sort of understanding enough to tell you what to expect. And it's literally 10 to 13 days of feeling like shit. And it changes, and it, you know, it gets kind of terrifying. We started off with a fever and chills and body aches and, you know, a lot of fatigue. And then next thing you know, last Wednesday, my wife just couldn't breathe. And it was going from just, I mean, she goes to Orange Theory 6 times a week. And she, you know, is in decent shape. And she couldn't walk to the kitchen without coughing for a minute straight because she couldn't catch her breath. And the confusion there is, what do we do? Because, you know, the doctors don't necessarily know, and you don't know if you need to go to the ER. And if you go to the ER, we have to be apart from each other. And, you know, I don't know how I come back home while she's in the ER. And the doctors and the nurses don't know what direction you're gonna go. And it's a scary thing. And I think that, you know, it becomes more real when it affects someone that you know. It definitely becomes more real when you have it, but they can't even give me a guarantee that I won't get it again. And like, I have it right now, and I have a letter from the North Shore Health Department that says I can leave the house and I can go do showings and I can, you know, whatever, and I can exist outside of the house now, but I don't know if I'll ever not wear a mask while this is going on. And the fact that I see people, like, just scrolling through social media while you have this and seeing people, A, politicize this, and B, make it out to be some sort of hoax or just not real, and you don't know what's gonna be in store for you the next day or the next hour, and there's no treatment, and there's no, like, the people who are the foremost experts on this can't give me any sort of directive as other than when I can leave my house. And it's a scary thing. Excuse me, sorry. It's a scary thing. I didn't tell my parents about it because there's nothing they can do but worry. I didn't want to tell anybody outside of who I had been in direct contact with because, you know, all they do is ask questions. And when you don't have any answers, it just makes every question more terrifying. And, you know, I feel better now, which is great. You know, I still don't feel, you know, 100% obviously. And, you know, there's anxiety issues. Like last night, I didn't sleep because I just had anxiety that maybe, you know, it wasn't done with me yet. And, but I just want people to like, just look, wear a mask, just wear a mask and be more cognizant of who you're around and what you do with your social distancing. And if you want to go out and be around people, fine, but just be more careful because it literally just takes like one lapse in judgment to, you know, it's to get it. And once you've made peace with yourself having it, then you have to be cognizant and aware that you could have affected other people. You know, I've wanted to hug Molly Triggs for 3 months. We hug each other all the time. And the day before I started feeling sick, we hugged each other. And then after I got tested, the first thing I thought about was if I had given her the virus. I had a conversation with Ross for about 30 minutes. We were sitting right next to each other. And I was worried about him. Like, it's just, it's a very concerning thing. And just don't, it's real. It is very real. And so just be very careful. And I'm happy that as bad as it was bad from home and not a hospital, but there's a lot of people who don't have that luxury. So, you know, I figured it was a good thing to, I appreciate Charlie giving me the opportunity to mention it because it's definitely something we should all consider and be kind of aware of. So.
Yeah, totally. No, thank you for sharing your story. It, again, guys, my goal in all of this isn't to create fear or anything like that. It is simply to utilize the platform that we have to educate others and the responsibility that we have of, not only to our clients, but also to our peers and also to our friends. And I know oftentimes, at least for me, it always, the impact of this always hits home once you know somebody who's gone through it. And I thought Newbie and I having a conversation yesterday and him coming out publicly with it, I thought it was just important for us to share his experience in it to just educate us all. And it's just a good reminder as we're starting to see an upswing in all of this. So Noobs, thanks for sharing your story. Awesome. All right, moving on. Next up is, as I'm going to continue to ask you as we shift through this market, is are you digitally based and physically enhanced, right? Are you, is your business digitally based and physically enhanced? So, Lindsay Vranick, tell us what's coming on Tech Tuesdays with Sales Pipeline.
All right, good morning, everybody. So today I'm talking about the sales pipeline. And so this isn't just for submitting for compliance review. You have an entire pipeline in here to utilize. And so this is your screen when you view opportunities. I'm sure everybody knows what this screen is about. But I really want to dive into the specifics of how to utilize this for your business. And I specifically want to highlight this morning the cultivate phase. So this is a great opportunity. The moment you have a conversation with a buyer or seller and then you have a conversation about real estate, whether they want to list their house in the next 6 months or they're looking to buy a home, add them to this cultivate phase. Obviously, add them in your database first if they're not already, but then put them into cultivate. And the moment you add that commission rate, which is a required field when you create the opportunity, and you add either the estimated list price or their budget, it's going to calculate the potential GCI so that you can get that overview and see that number in order to track your entire business for the year. So this is a super useful tool. If you're currently using an Excel spreadsheet to track your workflow, track your stages and your entire, lead to close process, take that and put that into command. I'm going to be going through how you can create those custom stages within those five phases that you see here, as well as adding those checklist items. And so I really want to get everybody on board with this and start utilizing this because it's a really great tool.
Awesome. Thanks, Lindsay. Guys, one of the biggest questions I always ask people when I'm in a coaching appointment or a consulting appointment is, what's the potential opportunity of your income? And 99% of people don't have a real clear understanding of what that looks like in really effectively communicating, okay, my pipeline right now for potential income looks like this, and here's what probable income looks like, and here's what I actually have pending, and here's what I have closed. And it's a great way to help you feel at ease as it relates to your income within this business. And it's a great tool within Command. So check out Tech Tuesdays with Lindsay this afternoon. All right. Now I am jumping it over for compliance updates with Kimmy, who's actually going to share her screen. So Kimmy Herbert, you're up.
Awesome. Good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk briefly this morning about the escalation clause. I've gotten a few questions on where to find it and then kind of strategies on how to use it. A lot of people are using this clause now with such a competitive market. So just kind of a general overview for those who don't know, the escalation clause is language you can add into your offer to automatically escalate the price in the event the seller receives another offer at or above your buyer's initial purchase price. So it kind of protects your buyer from not having to potentially offer too much unless they are in competition. So first, showing you how to access this, depending on where you are editing or drafting your forms. So right now I'm in zipformplus.com. So if you are executing your forms within Zipform Plus, these are the steps you need to take. You need to add a blank addendum. So we go to all forms, search on the under the WRA library. I like to use this blank addendum with dash 2000. The template is just a little bit cleaner. So once you add that, open it up, and essentially you're going to be inserting the language from our clause library. So you can see it's just a blank piece of paper, but it's set up so I can just use this as a template. So you're going to name it as addendum EC for escalation clause, insert the offer information, and then in this blank text box to access our clause library, you click on this pencil icon. And then you'll see this scroll icon, open that up. This will open the clause library. You can see there's a few different categories. The escalation clause is in the offer to purchase category. And then you're gonna search by title and it's right here under escalation clause. And then you click insert. And then from here, you go in and edit your information as far as the date of the offer, the purchase price, and what your buyer is agreeing to pay. So essentially you're saying my buyer here, I'm offering $500,000, but my buyer is willing to pay $3,000 more than any other offer received up to a maximum of $510,000. If you are editing in DocuSign Rooms, I'm gonna jump over here. We have this form set up kind of as just like a PDF. So within the DocuSign Forms library. So I'm gonna go to add from DocuSign Forms. And depending on whether you're in the Lake Country office or the North Shore office. So you see up the top here, I've got the DocuSign Forms library and I'm gonna select which specific library. So obviously Lake Country, you'll see 1126. North Shore, we'll see 972. And then right at the top here is addendum EC escalation clause. Click add. Lake Country, I just checked this morning. It was not, has not been uploaded yet, but I did reach out to KW and they will be uploading that hopefully today, the next few days. So you won't see this today, but in the next few days, it'll be here for you. So I'm opening up the addendum EC. So again, it's the same language. This is just kind of in a PDF format, again, with those blanks that you're going to be entering the information. One thing I want to note about the escalation clause. So every firm has essentially their own version of the escalation clause. They're all written, for the most part, with the exact same intent, but there's a few differences, one key difference with our the way ours is drafted. You can see at the bottom here, it states, seller may initiate such increase in purchase price only once. So what this means is the seller cannot, if they receive two offers, both with escalation clauses, the seller cannot use them to bounce back and forth until you get to the buyer's max agreed upon price. In this case, our escalation clause is written in a way that states the seller can only use another escalation or another offer one time to increase our price. There are other firms that have escalation clauses that state the exact opposite. They specifically state that the escalation clauses may bounce off of each other. So be aware of that. If your buyers, I should say, be aware of the fact that other agents may be writing with escalation clauses that do state that. And if you really want to give your buyer the best chance, if you know that there's multiple offers, that there's likelihood that there's other escalation clause written, you can strike this out so that the intent would be that they can bounce off of each other. But for the most part, I would say 90% of the time when I see agents writing these escalation clauses, we leave this language in here to protect the buyer from having to, you know, continuously bounce off the other offer that the seller received. So that is all I have for you today on the escalation clauses.
Kimmy, I had a quick question about that with the bouncing off of each other. So let's say in the scenario that you said that you had, there's an offer for 500 that has an escalation clause. And let's say there's an offer for 502 that also has an escalation clause. Can the 500 then go over the 502? And then does the 502's escalation clause kick in because it was just beat by the other offer? Does that make sense? So you're not playing them off of each other, but you're trying to engage both escalation clauses because the 502 offer got beat by the 500 and also had an escalation clause.
So I guess the simplest way to, I think, to answer that is when a seller receives two offers with both with escalation clauses, again, it depends on how they're written, but let's say it's written, you know, our offer is written with this specific language. So the seller is going to say, okay, I got an offer for both offers, say 500. The seller is going to take this specific offer and essentially, okay, let's use the example of this offer is 500,000. Buyer is agreeing to go $2,000 more than any other offer up to a max of 505. So if they're going to use the other offer, okay, escalation clause is triggered, automatically going up to 502, and that's it because it's triggered once from the other offer. So this offer, if they accepted this offer, it would be at 502 amended purchase price. We obviously don't know maybe what the other offer is. Maybe they're willing to go $3,000 more. If that's the case, then that offer would win with a higher price. Does that answer your question?
Yes, I think so. So if the other offer had the escalation clause of 3,000, would they be then going off of the 500 number or would they be going off of the 502?
The 500. It's that initial purchase price.
Got it. Okay. Yeah.
And here's, I have seen a lot of confusion come into play when there are multiple offers with escalation clauses. Ultimately, again, that price is amended. So buyer and seller have to mutually agree upon what that amended price is. And if there is ever a confusion on, I actually had a listing agent say, you know, I'm not sure what the amended price would be. And in that case, I would say maybe it's better to do a multiple counter offer of, okay, we're not gonna use the escalation clause. Buyer, you've shown me that you're willing to go up to 505, so I'm just gonna offer a multiple counter offer of your purchase price to be 505. Of course, in that case, you're always risking the buyer might choose to walk away and not move forward, but that may be the smarter thing to do to avoid any kind of confusion on what that amended price is to be. Awesome. Thanks, guys.
Cool. Thanks, Kimmy. All right. I am jumping back in here. All right. So Amanda Cotty, you are up next to showcase our July training calendar and upcoming events.
Awesome. So I'm going to first start talk about Bold. So Bold is coming back again in July, you guys, and it's, even if you took it a few months ago, it's completely reconfigured again for the market of the moment. So Bold is going to teach you exactly how to return to the basics. It's going to help you reset your mind and just ensure you can overcome all your limiting beliefs and obtain your big goals. So they took a look at agents who took the first Bold pivot versus those that didn't, and they had 14% more listings taken, 9% more contracts written, 46% more contacts created, and 39% more opportunities created as well. So usually $800, it's $99 starting halfway through July and going into August. So even if you took the last one, all new information, bunch of new teachers, so make sure to sign up for that. And then we have our July training calendar as well. So we'll get this out to you guys today. Enjoy the 4th of July. You'll see that there's no productivity coaching this Thursday, and we're closed on Friday, but then we're coming back after team meeting with a bunch of really great stuff. So make sure to check your times on things, as a lot's changed with Bold Pivot. So we want to make sure that everything is still in there, but times have shifted for some of the regular stuff. We have some really great stuff on Wednesdays. So all about maxing your commission, how to continue that conversation of keeping your commission on Wednesday the 8th. Then we have a Mega Agent Mastermind on the 15th. And then we're super excited. We have Phil Byers coming back to us on the 22nd. So he's going to talk all about thriving without trying. He really works his database. He's going to talk all about the 33 touch and how he really utilizes his database, especially in times like now, to just kind of has business coming in without, like he told Charlie and I yesterday on the phone, he's like, I'm not even doing anything. So he's going to tell us all about how he's just has business flowing in without even really trying. So, and then the 29th, we have another special guest. We have our regional tech trainer, Gordon, is going to be leading the team agent mastermind with some command tips. So we'll get this out to you guys today.
Awesome. Guys, I would highly recommend you circle your calendars on Wednesday the 22nd. If you like guys like Tommy Choi, Phil Byers is another one of those great downtown Chicago agents who just is the master of relationships and his database. He's a great guy, runs a big book of business, and he's always been willing to give back to us up in Milwaukee. So just an extra plug for the 22nd, but we're super excited about everything we have coming out for July. And as always, if you have any recommendations or requests, please feel free to hit us up. We're always looking to add content that is valuable for you and your businesses. So cool. All right. Now I am actually going to turn it over to Maureen, who is going to kind of lead us into an exciting announcement. So Maureen Stale, you're up.
All right. Good morning, everyone. So we have a really big announcement today, and we're super excited about it. And I just want to talk about around what it is we're going to be revealing today. And I've had this conversation in small groups about what is the value of growth within our organization. And Charlie gave me a really good example yesterday, and he said, think of crowdsourcing, right? I loved this phrase, 10 people have a bond that creates energy, right? So think of you first 10 people that were with us in my dining room, and the bond that we created and the energy that happened because of that bond. 100 people is dynamic, and 1,000 people is a movement. And that is the goal. That is what we're after, is changing the landscape of real estate in Milwaukee and how real estate is done. And that is being done by KW. We are definitely becoming a movement with over 470 agents in Milwaukee in less than 6 years. And interestingly, the reaction to the traditional brokerages is obviously a threat, but they're not changing the way they do business. You would think they'd sharpen their pencils and sharpen their style and change the way they do business, and they're really not. And I find that fascinating. Instead, they're going after scare tactics and kind of crazy things. So we've decided we are on the page of creating a movement and getting to 1,000 people. And when you create culture and an environment, it gives you the opportunity to share, right? And when you can share amongst each other with our inner Facebook pages, right, our private Facebook pages that we do, the amount of sharing that happens, the ideas that come out, the help that happens, and the diversity and thought and approach to our business. I mean, that's what we're looking to build upon. That is a movement when you've got that amount of people, right? And so we have found that we have, when you're talking about who controls this market, it's the leads that control the market. The market share controls the market. When you have the market share, you control the market, right? We control the market in North Shore. We control the market in Southwest. We are starting to control the market in Lake Country. And our next big venture is controlling the market in Tulsa, Elm Brook, which we're calling TEB, Tulsa, Elm Brook Market. We are officially announcing the opening of the Tulsa, Elm Brook Market Center on North Avenue. It's about 117th and North Avenue. We've got a temporary office there, big, huge KW. It's very prominent when you drive down North Avenue. It's across the street from a huge competitor, and we're super pumped about it. So Charlie's going to share a video.
Are you ready to do it? Yeah, I am.
So while he's setting that up, I'm going to just talk about Paul Niklick. Paul Niklick is our launch partner in this market center, and he's going to start off our video that we are going to go live with today. And it is official, and agents will have access to it, so we can talk about some of the details. Those things will go out from Charlie today, but I want to present this video.
I am so excited to announce that I will be a launching partner for our newest Milwaukee Market Center servicing Wauwatosa, Elm Grove, and Brookfield.
What makes Keller Williams' business model so great is honestly the transparency. Our number one agent, all the way down to a newly licensed agent right off the street, is on the exact same financial model. What this transparency does is this allows the agent to control the outcome to their income. So they're not competing either with their broker or their colleagues or people within their office year over year in order to improve their financial split. The agent controls it within our model. We just provide them the platform.
This business is all about relationship. And when you build the relationships and build your business at the same time, you can grow it into something really exciting. And it isn't about the brokerage. The brokerage is really there only to inspire and support you. It is not there to be the face of your business. You are the face of your business. The relationships are what take your business to the next level. And KW is just there to support you in doing so.
One of the great things about my job being on the leadership team for Keller Williams Milwaukee is that we work with the agents. We view our relationship with the agents as a partnership. And the better that we are able to serve you, the better you are able to serve your clients.
If you're interested in finding out more information about our newest location or just have questions about Keller Williams, feel free to reach out to me absolutely anytime. Thank you so much.
So where I also am going to share one other video with you, and unfortunately, Paul has had a little bit of a hiccup as it relates to his IT and equipment, so no worries. This is why, after learning from a few weeks ago of hiccups in IT, we had Paul pre-record a message to the group as it relates to our launch.
Good morning, Charlie and everyone. I'm having a little bit of technical difficulties here with my audio this morning, so wanted to just give a shout out to everybody and say how excited I am for the opportunity to be part of this launch for Tulsa, Elm Grove, and Brookfield. And Charlie, you asked me a couple of questions, one of which was the concept around why I chose KW as opposed to, say, going out into the marketplace and hanging my own shingle. And really, it's because everything that I've done over the years, it just so deeply aligns with what KW is. And what I mean by that is that everything that we do is centered around and focused around the agent. And we are here to serve the agents. And at its core, that is one of my biggest fundamental values. So, you know, I'm just looking really forward to what we're going to be doing in the future to support our agents. Not just in supporting the agents and their brand, but it's how I run my real estate business, where we constantly look to innovate our processes for the sake of giving our clients a better service, a better value. And what I'm looking to do is take it to an even higher level and apply that to the agents. Take what we're already doing really well and innovate a lot of what we do to support our agents. So I'm just really excited to start unrolling some of these things that we've been talking to our TOSA, Elm Grove, and Brookfield agents about, and just really grateful for the opportunity. So really, really thank you, everybody, and have an awesome day. Thanks so much.
Cool. So guys, a few just logistical updates for you to kind of wrap this up is we did take space. We did take space in the TOSA area, and I'm going to give you the logistics of what that looks like right here. It is the office location is on 11633 West North Avenue in just west of 45, directly across the street from Metro MLS. And a few other brokerages in the Milwaukee area, very conveniently located. Ironically, this was also the location that Todd and Andrea Weichert used to operate their RE/MAX office out of. So it's really perfectly set up well right now to be a co-working space with conference rooms, TVs, copier machines, a little kitchenette. So we're really excited about the space and to be able to offer a space to all of Keller Williams Milwaukee agents to be able to go in. Especially right now on Sunday, I got a phone call from someone who needed to write an offer and Collectivo was closed and Starbucks was closed and they knew something was happening in TOSA and they needed a spot to jump into. So, you know, we're really excited about growing scale and being able to provide more resources and opportunities for agents to do and serve their business at the highest level within and around the Milwaukee area. So I'll send out more details as it relates to the location and how to access it and things like that here this morning in our follow-up email. But if you have any other further questions, feel free. Don't hesitate to reach out to myself, Paul Nicolick, or Maureen. And we're happy to help share more details as we're going on this journey to continue to build out another location in Milwaukee. So, cool. All right. Last couple things is I wrap up this week is... I'm going to talk about one other thing as it relates to lead generation, right? And I was on a call this week actually with Gary Keller, ironically, and one of the things I've found in my conversations with agents is people are always looking for, what do I talk about when I'm lead generating? Like, if I have to pick up the phone, like, what do I actually say, right? And Gary mentioned something to me on a call that I was on last week, and he said, listen, 95% of your clients right now should be refinancing, right? Think about that. Rates right now, Craig Cooper, great guy, texted me yesterday, 30-year fixed rate was 2.75, I think. He said, listen, if you're above 3%, every single one of your clients should be refining, and it's a phenomenal opportunity for you to reach out of something of value to your clients to say, hey, I totally know you may not be buying or selling right now, but I think you should be really considering what a refinance would look like to help you take advantage of historically low rates. And I thought it was just a great little nugget or a great opportunity for you to take your database and touch your database, whether it's handwritten notes, phone calls, emails, text messages, to remind your clients and partner with some of your favorite vendors on the potential to refinance, and a great way for you to give back and utilize your resources to give back for your clients to be that real estate agent for life, who's thinking about them more than just the transaction they had with you or the one or two, but about their entire real estate experience. So I wanted to share that idea with you. Cool. All right, so wrapping up, market stats and insights. What does it look like this week? Well, it's kind of more of the same story. Showings are continuing to be incredible. State of Wisconsin here in the last week, what I would tell you is this, we continue to see the V-shaped recovery that we talked about really last week and correlated it to Dr. Yoon's statistics. When you look at number of showings this year versus last year, last week, Thursday, they were up 74%, Friday, they were up 73%, Saturday, up 73%, and Sunday, up 75%. So again, we're still seeing very strong buyer activity within the marketplace, which is very solid. And we'll continue to monitor that again because it correlates to demand. When you look at units under contract here, again, a V-shaped recovery. We've had a really strong last 4 weeks. When you correlate it to the last 4 week trend versus June of 2019's trend, we have now actually on a 4 week trend had more units go under contract this year than all of June of last year. So again, positive as it relates to units under contract latest 4 weeks. Again, correlative of demand. Here, sales absorption, same thing. Number of percentage of inventory in the market that goes under contract, really solid. I'm really looking at these numbers to make sure that we're continuing to trend in the right direction and that we're not seeing blips in the radar. However, there is one blip in the radar, and that's what I'm gonna show next. What you see here is new inventory units, right? And new inventory units were down about 100 units last week. You can see we really had a V-shaped recovery leading into middle of May, and it's been relatively flat, but losing 100 new units week over week is somewhat concerning. You know, I always say 1 week can be an anomaly, but 2 weeks is a trend. So heading into the 4th of July weekend next week, I will definitely be looking to see where this trends in the next 2 to 3 weeks to see where this could be going as it relates to our market. But again, inventory still remains very tight. And then here is the very simple analogy I provided you guys last week. I just thought was powerful to remind you where we're at and what this looks like over the last 2 years. You can see historically May through, let's just say October, we have about 10,000 units. And then every year in the fall, it dips to about 8,000 units. And then historically in February, it always rises to around 10,500 units through the summer and into early fall of 19. And then fall last year, it dipped totally normal, right, in historical trends. And the problem or the crunch that we're just feeling is that that trend never really saw the spring blip that we've had. So that's why I'm so watching new inventory units like a hawk, because I'm waiting for this thing to pop back up, because this is where the trend line we needed to see in terms of total inventory across the marketplace. So that is it for the week, guys. We're super excited. I thought it was a great bunch of information for the group. I will send out a bunch of follow-up this week. I would say this, please be safe with your families over the 4th of July. Enjoy the time off. Enjoy the beautiful, gorgeous weather that's upcoming. And if there's anything you need, please don't hesitate to reach out to anyone on the leadership teams between myself, Diana, or Mandy. We are happy and here to serve you. And with that, I wish you a great 4th of July. And the Lake Country crew, you can jump off for your Lake Country meetup. And the North Shore crew, I will hang around to do any new listing or buyer need recaps for the group. Cool. Thanks, guys. Have a great 4th.
Hello.
Yep, one sec.
Okay.